Foreign Minister Nanaia Mahuta is on her way home after the first visit by a New Zealand foreign minister to China since 2018. Her visit this week coincided with China President Xi Jinping's visit to Moscow. Associate Professor Nicholas Khoo is a China foreign policy researcher at Otago University. Kia ora, welcome to Q&A.
Kia ora, Jack.
From what we know about the trip so far, how did it go?
Went as well as to be expected. This is a very important relationship for New Zealand, and it's important that we get this exactly right. So it struck me that Foreign Minister Mahuta got the basics right, advanced New Zealand's interests, stated them very clearly, had the nice balance between interests and values. So I think we came out ahead on this. And if you look at the statements put out by the Chinese side, they've also said that they want to move the relationship to a new level, which is good news for everyone.
Yeah, talk to us about that a little bit more. How did you interpret the Chinese response to Minister Mahuta's visit?
Well, I interpret it in the sense of they are interested in a stronger economic relationship. Now, that's great news for us. But at the same time, we've got to take a broader perspective because New Zealand's foreign policy, it's not just about China. It's also very much about our relationship with Australia, our treaty alliance partner. At the same time, we also have a very strong relationship with the United States. So this important triad of relationships really anchors New Zealand's foreign policy. And it's very important that while we improve our relations with China, and that's great, at the same time, we've got to be very careful. We have a very strong alliance relationship with the Australians, and at the same time, very strong relationship with the United States.
Right. Let me ask about that then, and this might seem like a silly question, but is it a good idea for New Zealand to further improve its economic relationship with China right now?
Exactly. There's no particular tension between having a good relationship with China and improving our relations with our traditional alliance partners. Because we can have an even bigger part of the pie, and that's great. You know, improving the pie is always great. Right? Expand the trade pie. And that's a good thing. At the same time, we've always got to be aware that international relations is as much about politics as it is about economics, right? They interact in very complex ways. So we always need to keep a very close eye on not just the China part of things, which has received a lot of attention and deservedly so, but also the traditional alliance partners and partnerships that we have.
But is there not the risk of a major flashpoint sometime in the future, especially if we strengthen our economic links with China? Is there not a risk that we will find ourselves having to choose between our traditional allies, Australia and the United States, and our economic relationship with China?
Well, what I would say is that there's a risk in doing anything in life, including foreign policy. And we need to face the world as it is, right? So at this point in time, nobody's predicting that there's going to be a major conflict. Right, in the short run. But at the same time, there are tensions, which are well-documented over Taiwan, South China Sea, East China Sea. But we need to live in the present, and there's no reason why we can't actually focus on this set of relationships that are absolutely core to New Zealand's foreign policy.
I mean, you say there's no risk at the moment of anything significant, but let me just throw a hypothetical situation at you. I mean, the US intelligence agencies reported earlier this year that China was considering providing arms to Russia for the war in Ukraine. What would New Zealand do if it found itself in a position whereby you have essentially a proxy war between one of our longest and oldest friends, the United States, and our biggest trading partner, China?
Sure, that is tricky. My assessment is, and this, we'll see what happens. My assessment is that the Chinese look at this situation and they themselves do not want to get entangled in a tricky situation with the Americans. So my sense is that they will definitely not be doing this, right? Now, we will see whether this plays out. But if you look at it from the Chinese side, this is a very precarious situation that they need to exercise a lot of wisdom and judgment on, right?
A range of former politicians, Jim Bolger, Helen Clark, former New Zealand Prime Ministers, former Australian Prime Minister Paul Keating, have raised concerns about the AUKUS nuclear submarine deal between the US, UK and Australia. Do you think that their concerns about AUKUS are shared by the New Zealand government?
Well, let's put it this way. The New Zealand government is fundamentally interested in stability in the region, okay? And my assessment is that AUKUS, in the round, contributes to stability in the region. Now, let's step back a little bit. Why did AUKUS come about? It came about fundamentally because a policy by the Chinese government to pressurize Australia. And this sanctions policy has lasted from 2020 all the way through to the present day. Now, Australia cannot be expected not to respond. And this is what's happened. They've responded, they've taken on board their national security considerations and acted accordingly. So in many respects, if you take a broader view, AUKUS is not to be seen in isolation. It's part of a larger strategic situation in the region, which is becoming more and more complex. And a lot of the focus should actually be on why Australia felt its security was so affected that it had to actually respond in this way. So we need to keep that in mind at all times.
Let's look at the big picture. Sure. China's President Xi visited Moscow this week. So on one hand, we've heard that China is pulling closer to Russia.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, we've also heard that China wants to help broker a ceasefire between Russia and Ukraine. So how would you assess that visit?
I would assess this visit as highlighting the fact that there is actually a massive tension in Chinese foreign policy between its interest in values, such as sovereignty in the international system, and its interest, on the other hand, in a good relationship with Ukraine. So, you know, the more you dig down and look at Chinese foreign policy, they face a lot of challenges. It really is a serious problem for them. So whichever decision they make, they'll find themselves facing a very difficult situation.
The Ukraine war peace plan that has been proposed by China, is it fair to say that that is a plan that would benefit Russia more than Ukraine?
Well, peace benefits everyone, fundamentally, right? But again, the peace plan, if you look at it closely, suggests issues that China is struggling with. Point number one on the peace plan deals with the issue of sovereignty. Ukraine's sovereignty has been violated, right? And what is the Chinese response? You could argue that they're not actually holding up to their sense of what their values are, right? They're placing their interests above their values. This may not be a big surprise, but it should alert us to the fact that there's a lot more going on than what might appear at first hand.
China was also involved in brokering a diplomatic breakthrough between Saudi Arabia and Iran, who are, of course, traditional bitter opponents. Should we care that the United States is raising the alarm about that deal and a potential Ukraine-Russia ceasefire?
Well, let's put it this way, Jack. We shouldn't be surprised if the Chinese are seeking to play a bigger role in the international system. And we should be open to China playing a more constructive role. And this would be an example of them stepping up, contributing to peace in a contested region, the Middle East. Nobody can say they're not interested in stability in the Middle East. And to the extent that the Chinese are helping to contribute to that, bringing the Iranians and the Saudis together, that's a good thing. And we should all be promoting that.
Finally, New Zealand is undertaking a review of its defence policy at the moment. We're expecting a draft to be released sometime in the next few months. You said that the number one priority for New Zealand when it comes to the Pacific should be stability. Sure. And obviously China plays into this in a significant way. In your opinion, should New Zealand be focusing more on security when it comes to our foreign policy in the Pacific?
Definitely. Obviously, security can be defined very broadly. But however you define security, and I favour a broad definition that encompasses not just defence, but also social issues and so forth, environment, etc. If you look at security from that perspective, you know, we need to take the region a lot more seriously. Okay, we need to meet their needs. Otherwise, you're going to find that external actors are going to come in and meet those needs. So, for example, recently we just heard about the Solomon Islands signing an agreement with China to develop the port in Honorea. This is the exact type of situation which seems to be low threat and so forth that we need to be stepping up our game to really kind of meeting a foreign policy need of a neighbouring country in which we have a fundamental interest in.
And in your opinion, does that mean we should be investing in more defence assets for the Pacific?
Sure, that will be part of it, right? Fundamentally, we need to have a consultation with our partners, not just Solomon Islands, but the Pacific Islands Forum. Ask them what their requirements and needs are. If we don't do that and don't get into an extended discussion with them, we shouldn't be surprised if other countries come in and play a bigger role, right? So we really need to step our game. 21st century is turning out to be a lot tougher than many have predicted, and this is an example of it in our backyard.
Well, I'm glad we have you to help us pick through the detail. Thank you so much. Yeah. Associate Professor Nicholas Khoo.